Brad Keselowski finds his way into the final four at Homestead after a thrilling end of the race yesterday at Phoenix. And now we know who can win the 2017 Monster Energy NASCAR Cup Series Championship. We'll go over the top data to prepare you for Homestead as Prime Sports NASCAR, brought to you by Race Review Online on Prime Sports Network, starts now. All right, it's Monday, the 13th of November, 2017. I'm your host, Greg DePalma, as we've got ourselves four drivers, four left. The whole season comes down to this at Homestead on Sunday, so we've got a lot to talk about here in a short period of time, and we're going to do that as I introduce my co-host to the show. First of all, he's a former Racing Writer of the Year Award winner by the Fantasy Sports Writers Association and a NASCAR F1 writer at rotowire.com, CJ Radoon. How you doing, CJ?
Doing well. Thanks for having me.
All right, CJ. And also joining us is our auto racing partner and lead motorsports editor for racereviewonline.com, Eric Smith. Eric, excited about this week?
Thanks for having me. Yeah, real excited. Usually just get a little kind of the grind through the season and get recharged here these last few weeks for another couple months off. So really excited to see what Sunday holds out for us.
Yeah, I think that the crazy thing is how the last couple, because we talked about, it seems like we just talked about this yesterday, CJ, and I know we were going over this last year with Kenny Bruce. Matter of fact, Kenny will be joining me on Wednesday to get his opinion on it. But it just seems like yesterday when we were talking about how the winner of the championship winner has miraculously won the race. And how much longer can NASCAR be that lucky? Because that just usually doesn't happen very often. Or at least in certain sports like this, you would do think of this kind of points procedure. All right, especially like it happens in golf a lot. All right, we finished second or fourth or whatever. But to get the win and then the championship in the same race is something that NASCAR has been very fortunate of, CJ. And I just don't know if they can keep getting lucky, but we certainly hope so.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good storyline each and every year when it does happen. I think I do recall talking about this numerous times, and I think what's continually the most surprising to me is the fact that, like, look at Jimmy Johnson last year. He was not the best car. He was not the favorite going in. He started deep in the field, had his own issues throughout the afternoon, but, the stars kind of aligned and brought him to the front. So Kevin Harvick has done it multiple times. How do these guys get so deep into the season to then dig and find that little bit of extra on the day that it matters, the actual clutch performance to get the job done where everything has to go perfectly according to plan, if not even better? And I mean, there are so many variables that we talk about in auto racing and over a 400, 500 mile race or what have you. And so many things can go wrong. To have absolutely everything come together, to have one of those four people win, let alone being one of the underdogs of those four to come out on top, is just astonishing each and every time it happens. And I'm not sure that we can continue expecting it each year, to be honest with you.
Yeah, one of these years, it ain't going to work out that way. Now, just going back at the whole points formula, just to update everybody, and of course, there's been a whole lot of changes, Eric. Is there anything we need to know regarding this race, regarding anything that happened in the past, whatever kind of points or bonuses or stage points or anything like that? Is that any of that going to come into play into the race on Sunday?
This is the only race of all 36 this season where points are pretty much thrown out the window, really, for the four championship guys. Everybody else still, gets the same stage points and playoff points per se, but it doesn't matter since there's no more playoff races after this. So those guys are, it's as weird as it sounds, they're playing by a different set of rules than the other four, because the other four drivers' stage points don't count for them. So it's not like Kevin Harvick can win stage one, finish second in stage two, and then just get by in the final stage. They don't count. So basically, for these four, they come in with 0 points and they're going to leave with 0 points. It's just mano a mano, best man cross the finish line first, you're the champion. So everything else is thrown out the window. So these guys which kind of makes it interesting, is where you saw on the stages this year, how some guys may give up points in a stage to maybe short pit a little early, and then it will cycle back around and have the lead. You might see that more of these championship four this race. They're going to probably kind of quote-unquote how some of these tracks, they say they race like a road course, and they count the race, the laps backwards as far as pitting. These four, you'll probably see that because stage points don't matter to them. They want to be in the front at the end when it matters. And so kind of a long-winded answer there for no, the points based are out the window. Don't even worry about points on Sunday.
Okay, so there is – so but they do have the stages again.
Yes.
All right, now why?
That, you know, that would be quite a good question. That I'm not real sure what the stages are actually going to prove, other than just like a break to go to the bathroom, or if you're at the track, go to the concession stand. If you're at home, maybe get up and go to the bathroom and go to the refrigerator. Other than that, really, it's not going to do much of anything, because, like I said, for the top four drivers, it doesn't really matter. They gain nothing on any of the two stages. So,
and neither the other drivers. They're like, nobody gets extra money at all for finishing in any specific order during the race because of the stages. Nothing at all.
Nope. They are literally going to be about as meaningless as any other time during the rest of the season. It's because the other 32 drivers in the field on Sunday, those guys are just trying to get a good finish and go into the off season without really tearing up any race cars or getting injured or anything like that. So do they really care about stage points, even though they get points for them? No. What does it matter to them? And really, the other guys that have been eliminated, really, those guys would like to stay like in the top 10 of the overall point standings. But it doesn't really matter, because the ones that are going to Vegas for the banquet are already got their trips booked and going. The other guys that aren't are going to the Caribbean or overseas, or they're going to vacation. So they've checked out. So really, this race really means nothing other than whoever of the top four drivers and the championship four crosses the finish line first and the checker flag drops.
All right. Well, let's wrap up Phoenix. And there was no miracle for Jimmy Johnson this time around, CJ, when he blew his tire and wrecked right around lap 150. So we kind of talked about this last week. It just hasn't gone all that well for Jimmy outside of miraculously finding a way to win the championship last year. But still, it hasn't necessarily been his best couple of years. So it doesn't end particularly well. But still good for the sport to have a new champion. Nobody's crying outside of the 48 teams camp.
Yeah, his luck definitely came to a crashing end in Phoenix with that tire failure. It's really remarkable considering the run of luck that he has had. I talked about that last week and said it wouldn't be a surprise for him to luck into coming to Homestead ultimately anyway. But when you do look at his season, you know, we still got one race left to go. He does have three wins this year. He's got four top fives, which ironically, or oddly enough, probably not ironically, but oddly enough, Ricky Stenhouse Jr. also has four top fives. And then if you look at his top 10 count, he's only got a total of 11. You look at Jamie McMurray, who's actually got 17. That just kind of tells you what kind of season he's had. I mean, Ryan Newman's got 12. So, I mean, when you talk about somebody who is the pinnacle in the face of success in NASCAR having such a difficult season, a lot of it's boiled down to Chevrolet, but you just wonder kind of where that team went off the rails, what they need to do in the offseason to be able to move forward. And you know, Chevrolet not having a contender within the top five, or I'm sorry, in the top four going into Homestead to fight for a championship, that's something that's very unfamiliar to them as well.
You know, we talked about last year at Homestead how it seemed like driver after driver just choked away the opportunity to win. Some of them choked. Some of them just had to go for it. But that just opened the door for Jimmy Johnson to win. I think it was really Matt Kenseth who really looked like he choked more than anybody, though, last year towards the end of the race. And then, of course, what happened to Carl Edwards and that's what it also takes to be a champion, is to be able to deal with the pressure of the situation and to keep your head on straight. And that's something that Denny Hamlin did not do yesterday, Eric. I'm sitting there. I think a lot of people might have been sitting there for minutes. This was going on for lap after lap, and I got to imagine people were in Denny Hamlin's camp going, what are you doing? why aren't you letting him pass you? Are you insane? You don't have to worry about Chase Elliott. Of course, he has to win the race, and we completely get that. He wins the race, he screws you. But that's not something that you worry about at that point in time. He's going to pass you. I mean, we see that happen all the time. I mean, cars just are faster than other cars. And eventually, you know when they're going to pass you. How did he not know that Chase Elliott was going to either A, eventually pass him fair and square, or B, do what he did to him? I mean, why didn't he just let him go?
That's the million-dollar question. I don't know. And even after the race, he didn't even act like it was. It's almost like everybody was crazy for even asking him that. He clearly had a superior car. Basically, going to that final stage, we knew it was going to be between Hamlin and Keselowski for that fourth and final spot of the championship four. And I don't know if it's maybe a crew chief not relaying information onto him, a spotter or what, but he should have known that at that point after stage two when he won, and they should have told him, hey, look, now you're tied for that last spot with Brad, and oh, by the way, he hasn't been in the top 10 all day. And in fact, he's outside the top 15. Just maintain. Don't even worry about winning the race at this point. Just outfinish him is all you have to do. And then you get to 40 laps to go or 45 laps to go, and Chase Elliott's right behind him, and he bumped him. That's the other thing. Yeah. He bumped him 2-3 times.
Yeah.
At what point as a driver do you just, like, swallow your pride and just, you know, like sometimes stick their hand out the window net and wave him by? Why would he not do that? Because he would only lost one spot, because at that point those two were far enough ahead of the next car that he could have, even in turn one, maybe kind of took a really high line so Chase couldn't even run you up the track, because it would have hurt him if he tried to get closer up to you. Just get out of the way, let him by, hop in line behind him, and just follow him at that point. What did you have to lose? Plus, you had at that point in the race, too, you had Matt Kenseth leading the race, who's Hamlin's teammate, and Martin Truex Jr. was running second, who's another Toyota driver, a satellite team for Joe Gibbs Racing. So those two obviously made it somewhat difficult for Chase to get by, and then Matt ended up in the end getting back by and winning. So I honestly don't know what in the world Denny Hamlin was thinking, because if he just lets him by, he's in the final four right now. We're not even talking about this. But
yeah, I mean, I think the only thing was, but there weren't 5 or 10 laps to go, CJ. I can understand, all right, I can't let Chase get by me. He might be able to win this thing, and I'm out. But there were enough laps left in this race, and why couldn't – if he just let him pass, I mean, why couldn't he have just – reverse the situation and got right back on Chase's butt? That could have happened. So there were just way too many laps to go at this particular racetrack to think, oh, if Chase Elliott gets by me, he's going to win this race, and I can't win. So I don't understand it, and that's definitely where communication with the crew chief needs to come in handy. And I can't blame everything on Denny. He needs a little help there.
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, it was still very early in the race, and he had, you know, the entire race ahead of him. Any number of things could have happened, you know, in the laps to come. And it was clear, I think, that he had a better car overall. Maybe not at that given point in
the
race.
That's the other thing, sure. Yeah, he had a great car.
At some point, you know, he was going to be able to make the small adjustments that would have been able to put him back there. But to not have the wherewithal to recognize that you're racing a guy that you had almost fisticuffs with just a couple of weeks ago, is not your best friend. Created a huge controversy that early in the race. He needs the heads up call from the crew chief, from the spotter, whatever, to say, you know what, give it a rest this time. But like you said, you know, Elliott was bumping him already, so it wasn't like Elliott was gonna back off at any point. So it was kind of that. It's kind of like you said, you've got to have that mental awareness to be able to make the right decisions under pressure. Hamlin was under pressure, and he had everything to lose, whereas Elliott did not. And unfortunately, you know, Hamlin just didn't make the right call there.
You know, Elliott passes him, Eric, and you kind of figure, wow. And then, of course, Elliott eventually passes Kenseth for the lead. And, you know, sure, we understand what happened with the tire pressure and all that. And then it was designed more for shorter, for more of a shorter run. And eventually he was going to lose it. But nobody knew. Maybe a caution came. I'm sure a caution could have come out. And then all of a sudden, Elliott finds himself restarting with the lead, maybe wins the race. But still, we weren't thinking about that. We were thinking once he passed Matt Kenseth and had the lead, it was almost like, well, how is Chase going to blow it this time? Because it looked like he was in complete control of the race at that moment. And all of a sudden, it's like, you got to be kidding me. He starts losing time to Kenseth. And then once Kenseth got right back on his butt, you were like, you knew he was going to get passed, and you were like, here we go again.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And this is the other thing that goes back with the Denny Hamlin situation with it too, is Chase falling off. While he looked strong there, it wasn't a shock for me to see it play out exactly as it did, because I was charting, and I know these guys get the same, if not more, information obviously than what I get.
Sure.
But on short term speed, Chase Elliott had really good speed. Hence what you saw after that caution flag. He kind of shot out of the bat out of the cannon. Basically, that's why he got on Hamlin. He got by. He battled with the Toyotas, and the short run speed, he had the first top two as far as single lap speed, as far as all weekend. But you look at a 10 lap average and more, he was 17th and 18th respectively in both practices on Saturday. So that tells you he's got good short speed,
okay,
but he doesn't have good long speed. So with that just coming out of a restart, you knew that he would have speed. You knew public enemy number one was Denny Hamlin. He was going to make basically Hamlin's life hell trying to get by him, which he did. Then he had the good enough speed to close the gap with the two Toyotas and get by, but he was going to fall off, which is what we saw. And then again, which Hamlin should have known that, a spotter, a crew chief, somebody should have told him that. He has that same information. They chart all every lap from practice. And then somebody should have told him about 50, 60 laps in a run, the Chevrolet tires, I don't know whether it was just from a setup standpoint or what, but the beads were kind of running down, and like Jimmy Johnson, a bead went down, blew his tire in the wall. Dale Earnhardt Jr., that caused that caution to bunch it up a few cautions ago, right front tire. Chris Buescher got in the wall, which caused that flames, which was kind of funny, that getting over the safer barrier, but another right front tire, and he's a Chevrolet driver. So Chase Elliott being a Chevrolet driver with the right front, I guess, kind of concerns that they should have had, and his long-term speed, he didn't have it. That's where Hamlin should have known better and let him by, and should have, even if he knew he got to the Toyotas, that he was going to fade. And exactly played out what happened, because it looked like at the end, Kenseth was a good second quicker than he was. I mean, he closed right up on his bumper and passed him like he was pretty much sitting still, which if those guys would have been taking that information, they should have known that at that point of the race. But Hamlin should have known that Chase doesn't have the short run,
yep,
or the long run speed.
Yep.
So why battle him? And that's what happened. So
and that's also why it's a team effort. That's what we yep, talk about in this show for the last several years. And it's why whoever wins the championship on Sunday, somebody sooner or later is going to bring their crew chief up with them. And just like you do, say, in a Super Bowl, when the manager's there with the trophy and not just, say, the MVP, you know, it is a team effort. And the driver shouldn't be standing there alone. The driver needs to be standing there with his crew chief. And that needs to be immediate, not 5 minutes later, not 15 minutes later. Now let's just bring him in. The crew chief is every bit as important as the driver to winning championships. And I think that's what we saw in this situation with Denny Hamlin. He didn't have Jack in house.
No, I agree. I mean, he should have had his crew chief in his ear, basically. Because I can't imagine trying to drive a race car with those speeds that they turn, even Phoenix, I mean, they're still going over 120, 130 miles an hour on a straightaway, and turning with the G-forces that you feel in each turn, and the concentration level that it takes to stay on, hit all your marks, plus you're racing around other cars, plus you got championship implications, and then have to know what Chase Elliott did in practice, and
yeah,
what lines
yeah,
he's running. That's the crew chief that should tell him that, and about the playoff situation where he stands in points. And from what I heard, they didn't say anything to him, and that's where I don't slight Denny in that aspect. That's more of the crew, that somebody should have made him aware of that. He's out there trying to drive and do his best. That's almost like in basketball or football and playing the Super Bowl or Game 7 in the NBA Finals or an NCAA tournament game where the players are out there battling. They're competing. They're trying to win, and the coach is over there calling plays.
Yep.
Where was Denny Hamlin's coach calling the play to tell him to get out of the way and let Chase Elliott
yep,
buy in, and here's yep, why. But he didn't have that, and that's why I think they're in the situation they're in right now.
Yep, and that's why, as we've talked an awful lot over the years about how not only Chad Knaus, but of course some of the other really top-notch crew chiefs like Paul Wolf and even, of course, Todd Gordon, when we talked about that last year. What do we know, by the way? I mean, how well respected or where does somebody like Mike Wheeler, where is he, CJ, as far as crew chiefs?
Well, I mean, to get to the pinnacle of the sport with Joe Gibbs Racing and et cetera, all these top teams, you got to be on top of your game. I think that just like drivers, though, when you talk about who the stars are, who's had success, you have Ray Evernham that kind of molded the kind of what ultimately produced or set the mold, I guess, is ultimately produced a Chad Knaus type of person. You've got other people that come at it from different angles. They spend their lives around the sport or they grew up through the organization that's on hand. You've got some that just really have that foresight and are able to click really well. A lot of it's personality, a lot of it's management style, and a lot of it's understanding the limitations of your organization and your machinery. So all of them are supremely qualified, supremely capable, but those that have that extra little bit of institutional knowledge like Knaus has of Hendrick Motorsports or Gordon has of Penske, et cetera, I think that's where the true differential comes in. They know the limitations of their driver. They know where they can push them. They know the relationship and how they can get the most out of both the driver as well as the machine and the people that are working on the machine, that they're able to deliver that product on track. And for whatever reason, if you've got just that little bit of piece that's missing where you don't know what your driver needs at a given second, you're not anticipating it to be able to deliver that piece of information, somebody like Denny Hamlin, who's in a situation like he was on Sunday, is going to react by the seat of his pants, which in racing ultimately isn't always your best decision.
Matt Kenseth gets the win, and I guess you think you think Matt's pretty upset now about the fact that he's not at Homestead, Erica, with the other three drivers, saying, hey, you know, I mean, I really earned my way in here in all reality. I just didn't get the help from my crew, which is interesting because he's had one of the best crews over the last couple of years. But it was the crew that really screwed him this time.
Yeah, how ironic is that? And here we're talking about NASCAR and racing, a team sport, and Kenseth does everything he's supposed to do. Even at Kansas, at the last race of the round of 12, he's just an innocent bystander there off that big melee there off the turn two with like 60 laps to go. And he gets caught up in the crash, but he didn't have too much damage. And he pits like nobody, like anybody would have done. The red flag comes out, and they're sitting there, and they come up with a game plan. And I've heard the audio with Jason Ratcliffe, his crew chief, is telling these guys, make sure six guys over the wall. We can't have more than six guys over the wall. He kept telling them this, coaching them. They lift the red flag. Seven guys go over the wall.
Well, so, how do they know when he says make sure that we only have six guys over the wall? How do they not know, like, the guy who wasn't supposed to go over the wall, how does he not know that?
You would think he should. And out to me, in hindsight, what I would have done if I was Jason Ratcliffe or any crew chief now that's ever put in that situation, I would literally come down off the pit box. I would pull my team all behind the pit box. And I would count six guys, and I'd tell them basically, you go stand on the wall. Everybody else do not leave this spot. And unfortunately, with grown men, you shouldn't have to do that. You think they would be smart enough to realize what each person's job is and what they got to do to this wrecked race car to hop over the wall to fix it. But one extra person, and here Kenseth gets parked. Well, he would have advanced because Jimmy Johnson did not have the car to advance at Kansas. He spun twice in a span of five laps right before that. They admitted that they didn't have the car to advance. And when Matt had that problem, they knew all they had to do was get a top 20 to advance. And they did that. But Kenseth didn't have a whole lot of repairs that they needed. He would have advanced on. And then he wins at Phoenix, which that's why I think you saw him so emotional, is it all kind of came full circle. He knew that this was probably, after 51 races that he hasn't won, that this was probably the last one that he'd get. Homestead would be difficult, but if what happened at Kansas doesn't happen and he wins at Phoenix, he's in the championship four. And what's that say about a driver? He's basically been saying all along, I'm not done. He said in his press conference yesterday that I don't feel like I'm done. I feel like I still have at least one or two championship winning seasons left in me. I can compete at a high level. Look at what I just did. I mean, he passed a playoff guy for the win. He outlasted everybody, wins at Phoenix. The playoff race, which no non-playoff driver has won since 2013, and Kenseth gets a win, and here this guy doesn't have a ride next year. And last year, at the same track as Phoenix, if you guys remember right, Alex Bowman on a restart got into Kenseth while he was leading with like five laps to go. If Kenseth wins that race, he's in the championship four last year too. So all of a sudden, a guy that should have been there in the championship four two straight years, and he's out pretty much not of his doing under certain circumstances. and this guy doesn't have a ride for next year. And that's pretty much the emotion he saw at it. And was like, look what I can do still. And nobody wants to hire me. And he made that point yesterday, because he was asked the question about, now, are you retiring? Are you walking away? Did you not have any other offers? Does this kind of solidify what is going on? And he basically mentioned that he did have other offers without saying. He said he's got other teams that have approached him, sponsors that have approached him. But once he learned that he wasn't going to be back with Joe Gibbs Racing, he said that he had his eye on two or three car openings, a.k.a. Stuart Haas Racing. The other one might have been Childress, Richard Petty Motorsports, because he made a reference that two or three of those rides have already been filled and they didn't choose him.
Okay.
And he said that kind of hurt him. Uh-huh. So if you look at recently who got those rides and you say, oh, okay, he's referring to that. And then you can look at what rides are left, probably talking about maybe Front Row Motorsports. They've got two open rides. Sees that he's not going to win races or championships, and he doesn't want to run for those teams. And he basically said nothing against those teams, but I want to run. If I'm going to go out, I want to go out as a champion. I don't want to run mid-pack. And that's where yesterday you saw the emotion out of him is, look, I could still do this. I don't want to run for a mid-pack team. Look what I can do if given the chance. And basically, all you owners out there didn't want to take a chance on me. And that's where I think you saw his emotion.
Yeah, I mean, look, well, is the only reason why Matt Kenseth is no longer with Joe Gibbs, CJ, because of, like, someone like Suarez is just a younger driver and he just wanted to go that route? It's not sponsorship, right? I mean, what is the exact – and who's taking his place next year?
Next year we've got Eric Jones coming over from Furniture Row.
Okay, so all right, so that makes sense. But so is that really all it is? It's just a couple younger drivers, and they just want to go younger, even though you would think – I mean, look, we know Matt Kenseth is a better driver than those two kids right now. So I don't know. It's just a very weird situation because of the fact that you really better be sure about what you're doing with certain younger drivers, because you are risking – the possibility of winning some championships over the next couple of years with a guy like Matt Kenseth, who's definitely more than capable of doing that.
Yeah, it's definitely a long-term move for these teams that are going for the younger drivers, and they've typically had these drivers under their wings for quite a while already too. So it gets to the point where you've got these young, hungry drivers that are ready to come in. They've got sponsorship with them. And you know, you run the risk of them jumping ship and going to one of the other top teams if you can't give them a top ride. And we saw a number of teams with open seats for 2018 this year that are, you know, are pretty attractive rides. They're not, you know, down at the back of the field. And then, you know, you make the long-term play. You know, Kenseth's got, what, maybe another 2-3 years in him, whereas if you bring somebody like an Eric Jones on board, you might have a couple of decades ahead of you of potentially winning many, many championships off into the future. So you got to make that trade-off at some point as a team owner. I don't envy Joe Gibbs for having to make that decision, because clearly Matt Kenseth still has it. But then give all the credit to Kenseth in the world. I mean, look at Clint Bowyer, who took a step backward last year before moving over to Stuart Haas, and look at just the trials and tribulations that he suffered throughout 2016. He's only now just starting to get back on track, but that's kind of like a wasted year of his life and probably of one of his better years in which he's able to perform. We see Jimmy Johnson going downhill. We saw it with Dale Earnhardt, and I'm sure Kenseth's time would be coming as well. So I think the team's just got to continue looking to the future. And, you know, they don't make a lot of money, and they don't get the success that they get by making the easy decision. They've got to make the hard decisions all the time, and I'm sure that went into why Kenseth's not coming back next year.
All right, let's get into this last race preview now, and we'll start with Brad Keselowski, who I mean, look, he did win a race to get to this point. So there's that. Also, really, if you look at it, he really hadn't done much at all the last few races, did he? I mean, he's very fortunate with a couple of incidents that he had in both races, Eric, for him to even be here. So I guess if people are looking, I guess if you're now he does have – he's a former champion, so he's got that going for him. I do have to believe, though, that he will be the – if there is such a thing, he'll be the long shot out of the four.
Yeah, he certainly would be out of those four the long shot. I mean, he really backed his way into the championship four. Just you look at how bad his races have gone the last few weeks. You got Tech, obviously Martinsville. He did really great, won both stages, got those 20 stage points, which clearly now looking at it helped him advance on. But at Texas, gets involved in that first lap incident there with Kyle Busch. But it shows a testament how strong his team was. They overcame it. They didn't get any stage points, but they finished fifth at a track that he's typically struggled on the last 2 years. Then they go to Phoenix and just, I mean, he was just abysmal all week and had no speed. In practice, he was 17th, 21st, and 9th in the three practices. But you look at the 10-lap averages, Keselowski was 10th and 13th. He qualified 16th. It's about, and he finished 16th. That's about where he kind of a car that he had. And that worries me going into Homestead if that's pretty much all he's got. He's openly said that their mile and a half program is just, they don't have it this year. So really the only way that I think Keselowski wins this championship is he's going to have a race at Homestead like Jimmy Johnson had last year. I think he's going to have the exact same race. I don't think he's going to qualify up front. I think he's going to run kind of mid-pack, and he's got to hope that there's maybe a wreck that takes out a couple of those guys out, which look at the guys that are racing in it. You got Kyle Busch and Kevin Harvick, two hard-nosed racers, two guys that are not afraid to rev somebody up, two guys that will probably lean on each other at some point in this race. What if they both wreck? Now all of a sudden you got Keselowski battling Truex for the championship, and we've seen how bad of luck that Furniture Row Racing team can have at times. So while he's the long shot, I could still make a case that he can still win it, but he's got to have some help. I don't think he can win it based off pure speed alone.
And this would be also for Penske. This would be an opportunity to win NASCAR and IndyCar titles in the same season, correct?
That is correct. That is something that's never happened before. Joseph Newgarden won the IndyCar championship in September, and now you got Brad Keselowski looking at trying to win the Cup championship, which would be a big feat for the organization to do that. And that would be something they would definitely hang their hat on. And they could say, look, we've got championships in both two of the major forms of motorsports racing in North America, and we won them both in the same year. Plus, Keselowski has been openly said, I don't know who said this. I have never heard a driver or a team say this, but he said people have said that his 2012 championship was a fluke, that it was just kind of, there was a one-year thing that he'll never win again. Again, I've never heard anybody ever say that before.
You know, it's probably because of when he won it. He wasn't really an established driver at the time. Maybe that's why he's thinking about that, even though
that
he's actually earned his reputation a lot more since the championship. So I don't know. Maybe he heard something when he won it at the time, but since then he's definitely been and lived up to the hype. So
He's a quality champion,
sure,
but he's holding that chip on his shoulder where he is actively pursuing the second championship to say, look, that one wasn't a fluke. Look what I can do.
Yeah.
So, hey, if that's what you, any kind of motivation you need, go for it. I'm not one to say, hey, because you go hear people say bulletin board material. Well, that's his bulletin board material, and he's hanging by it until he wins a second championship. So good for him on that. So,
okay.
But, yeah.
CJ, now, Martin Truex Jr. has probably got the most pressure, because out of these drivers, he's never won before. And he's been so dominant all season. Now, I don't know. I'm not willing to say that because he's been phenomenal on the 1.5-mile tracks, that that's going to translate to Homestead. I can understand why you may think that. But if you just look at it, he hasn't been particularly that strong at Homestead recently. So I don't think that's going to fall into the equation for me. But I don't know. I mean, again, I think if there's any pressure on anybody, it's got to be Truex. We'll see how he handles it.
Well, yeah, this is Truex's year, isn't it? I'm not sure that anybody could put together a better season than Truex has had this year. It's just been phenomenal. So many wins. He's been up front just about every single week, regardless of what type of track it's on. He's had his problems, without a doubt, but he didn't have the long patches of dry spells like, say, Kyle Busch had at the beginning. So if there was anybody who just pretty much everything went right for this season, it would be Truex. So I would agree in that he has the most pressure coming in to Sunday's race. And you're right, he hasn't done very well at Miami Homestead. He hasn't finished in the top five since 2013 at the track. And in fact, that's only his third top five, I believe, since starting at the track. So he's got 12 starts, three of the past years. His best finish is 12th. He's only led three laps, and that was 2 years ago in 2015. So, you know, he's going to have a really tenacious Kyle Busch on his tail, too. So how you respond to that, how you set up your car, I know they tested at Homestead earlier in the season, so maybe they figured something out there. But just because it's a 1.5-mile track doesn't mean for me either that he's going to be completely dominant. And I'm very curious to see how he handles the pressure on Sunday and what he and his team are able to roll out in terms of speed early in the weekend.
Yeah, I don't think there's any question that he's been the best driver all season, the best team all season, but that doesn't always mean you're going to win a championship, Eric, and throwing the pressure. And speaking of Kyle Busch, and not just because he's my favorite driver, but I actually, if I'm going to pick somebody, it's going to be Kyle. I think that the pressure is not going to affect him, nor will it affect, maybe even a driver like Kevin Harvick. I know how good Kyle can be in these situations. When he needed a win, at Homestead, he did, even though he doesn't have a tremendous, history at the track, but, it's good enough, especially when he won it. And that's what I expect to see, from Kyle Busch. I think they're going to have their big boy pants on Sunday, and I think they're going to be awfully tough to beat.
I agree. I think he's going to be right there. I mean, I look at where yesterday at Phoenix, he didn't lead a lap, but he didn't need to. But
yeah,
that was the first race he hasn't led a lap since Daytona in July. So what does that say? He's going to be up front leading laps on Sunday. I have no doubt in my mind, which therefore puts pressure on the other three drivers. And Kyle's a guy that, you know, some guys are good being chasers and some guys are good being chasees. Kyle's good at both. He doesn't care. He has, like, basically the nerves of steel. He's not going to let anybody running behind him change the way he runs his line. He is just going to go all out all 400 miles on Sunday. While he does have a 19.83 average finish at Homestead, the worst among the four drivers left,
mm-hmm.
He does have four top seven finishes in his last 5 years there. So he's turned it around. He's got a Toyota. He's going to have speed. He's got the head. He's got the heart. He's got the car. He's got the talent. So it's hard to bet against a guy like that. And if bad luck, the only thing that's going to keep him down is if he gets caught up in somebody else's wreck, which I don't think he will because he's going to be running up front, or if he's going to have to avoid that, you know, that dreaded pit road speeding penalty or a loose wheel. It's going to be on the pit crew, which we have to remember, if you remember at the very beginning of the playoffs, they took his pit crew that pitted his car all season away and they put Daniel Suarez's pit crew on it. So this pit crew hasn't been in this situation before. Oh, actually, I'm sorry. They were. They were in this situation last year with Carl Edwards. So they've got the history here. Kyle's got the history here. They just don't have it together. And they've got a good team. Like, we've been talking about that this whole show about teamwork. I just think Kyle Busch has it this year. I do think he's going to be a tough out.
All right. And then Kevin Harvick, CJ. Kevin's my second choice because of the fact that how well he's done at Homestead. And after winning a couple of races ago, you know, he didn't have that need to win kind of deal last week, kind of like Kyle Busch. So he kind of just went through the motions. So I don't really think I worry too much about a solid fifth place finish. But I think we talked about this last week, and that is that he seems to be he seems to be going pretty well right now. Matter of fact, if you look at it, there's only been, I think, one other time this season that he's had four straight races in the top 10, finishing in the top 10. And that just shows you that I think that he's kind of dialed in, throwing the fact that he's been real successful at Homestead, and he would be my second choice.
Yeah, he's got everything kind of going in his direction right now. It just hasn't been as long as we've seen it from Truex as the year has gone on, but certainly the team has made the adjustments that they needed to make to be competitive in the playoffs. And winning at Texas certainly gave them a lot of confidence. And I think I said that after that race. And looking at his record from Homestead, he hasn't finished outside of the top 10 at the track since 2007. The last three races there, he hasn't led fewer than 40 laps. It's been an impressive performance from him, impressive spell, both at the track as well, at this particular track, as well as the last couple races in this season so far, building up to the championship. I'm not sure I would put him second on my list in terms of, you know, my picks to win. I definitely would put Kyle Busch up there. But I think if there's anybody that would not be a surprise or is a close second to the co-favorites, it would certainly be Harvick, based on the fact that he's got three top fives in a row heading into this weekend's race. And like you said, he's got such a great record at Homestead.
Who's your favorite then?
My favorite is Kyle Busch, actually. I agree with everything that both of you said. I think that he's got the heart, the tenacity. He's got the machinery to be able to get it done. He's good in every single situation. And when it comes down to a winner-take-all kind of situation, you know, he's the king at those types of things. Next close is probably Kevin Harvick. You're right, but I just think Martin Truex has a better team and better equipment under him than Harvick for this weekend.
Yeah, and I just – the only thing about that, Eric, is that, I'm not saying that – again, I think Truex and those guys, they've earned it. They're the best – if there was just an award for the best driver and team all year, it's them. But that's not the way it works. And I think being a first-time kind of thing, let's see if the pressure doesn't get to them. Let them go out there and prove that to me. I think it may get to them. Not just that, but they're facing former champs. He's facing three former champions. And I think because of that, throw in the crew chiefs that are with those guys – and boy, do I just think it's going to be awfully tough for them, especially because they don't have that much of a great track record at a specific location. That's the reason why I figured, you know what, I know he's going to be one of the top two choices. He's probably going to be co-favorite along with Kyle in the race. But I'm going to put that pressure. It's just going to be a little too much for those guys.
Yeah, I agree. I would say I originally ranked him. I had Truex in my head with saying, yeah, he's the favorite, right? But you got to look at Toyota's going to come down there. They build all the cars. Joe Gibbs Racing gets all the cars first. I mean, they supply everything for Furniture Row. So wouldn't you think Kyle Busch is going to add the best car? Not saying that there's a big discrepancy between them, but Kyle Busch is going to get the best of the best of the Toyota. It's been that way all year, and Truex has still overcame it. But look at the pressure. They're coming from Denver, Colorado. Again, we talked about this a couple years ago. These teams are coming from North Carolina. Furniture Row is coming from Denver, Colorado. They've got a trip on their hands. It's a different race for them, and it's only their second appearance. He finished 12th in 2015. It's familiar. The three of the four drivers in 2015 championship four, and this one, Kyle Busch won the championship that year. It's hard to beat Kyle. And then you got to look at it's Ford. Ford hasn't won a championship since 2004. They're finally back. It's Ford Championship Weekend. You got they're sponsoring the truck series, the Ford EcoBoost 200 Friday night. They're sponsoring Xfinity series, the Ford EcoBoost 300 on Saturday. They're sponsoring the Cup race Sunday, the Ford EcoBoost 400. You know they're coming with their best stuff, and that's scary when you got Kevin Harvick the recipient of that. So I agree with both of you. I think it's going to be Kyle and Kevin for the win. I just don't – it's a lot of pressure for Truex. Look what he did last year, and he didn't win the championship, and here we go again. And I just – they've made some mistakes here in the playoffs, you know, restarting below the white line in Kansas. They've had a loose wheel. They've missed lug nuts. They've overcame all that. They've got a top five finish in all nine races, or in eight of the nine races, the lone exception of Talladega. But I just don't know if they can do it on Sunday. Where right now, I think I'm going to go Kevin Harvick. If I had to pick one right now, just because the stars are kind of aligning,
okay,
I'd go Harvick first, and I'd go Kyle Busch second, and I think Truex may get a top five, and Keselowski may struggle to get a top 10.
Well, you know, maybe the fact that they actually had a shot last year, even though it didn't go too well, maybe that learning experience will serve them well here. But again, it's a lot different when you come into a situation like they did last year as a big long shot, as opposed to this year with all the expectations on you. But we'll see. That's why, look, it's a sporting event. Anything can happen. And we'll definitely have fun following it all week and talking about it when we do this again next week. So, Eric, I appreciate it. Maybe we'll get a chance to talk to you again for a few minutes in a couple of days when we talk with Kenny Bruce, because I know you're going to be up to speed on everything going on over at Homestead all week long over at Race Review Online.
Yep, absolutely. Yep, I'll be available for whenever.
Excellent. Thanks, Eric, and thanks, CJ. We need to talk for sure. Probably, I don't know, maybe at the end of the week or maybe race day or something like that. We have to get caught up on our futures and all of that because we have one more race to go for our futures.
That is true.
Yeah, so we got to do that. All right, so we'll talk to you guys again definitely at least one more time before Sunday's big race. And don't forget to check back with us on Wednesday at 5 o'clock when we have Kenny Bruce from NASCAR.com joining me to get his opinion on what's going on for the race on Sunday and everything else going on in the NASCAR Sprint Cup Monster Energy Cup Series. And that'll be on Wednesday at 5 o'clock. So we'll see you again on Wednesday. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter at PrimeSN. And thanks for tuning in here to Prime Sports NASCAR, brought to you by RaceReviewOnline.com.